I definitely logged my time living and working in large cities, and I've always worked in offices, whether it was in New York or elsewhere.
That's Heather May in the US there. She recently swapped her workplace in a big city for a more rural location without changing jobs. She could do that because everyone these days is working from home, and, well, home can be anywhere.
The idea of working remotely was really exciting to me because of the amount of time you spend commuting and just the stress. And I just loved the idea of working more autonomously and was really keen to get out of the city and find a quieter lifestyle.
Heather's one of many, many office workers who's welcomed the global shift to home working. In the US, 97% of office workers have been working from home during the pandemic. 82% say they want to continue to do so at least once a week in future. That's according to a survey of nearly 3,000 respondents done by Global Workplace Analytics in the US. The winners from all of this may well be some smaller cities in America. They're luring office workers like Heather May away from the big smoke. Heather spoke to my colleague Edwin Lane.
Florence, Alabama is part of the Shoals. And if listeners are familiar with Muscle Shoals, it's the home of Fame Recording, Muscle Shoals Recording, Etta James, Aretha Franklin, the Rolling Stones, all recorded. And it's right off the Tennessee River. They call it the Singing River. And there's a reason for that because, I mean, you really feel and hear the music just in the air. It's a very energizing and also really peaceful area.
Heather works for a fashion tech company based in San Francisco. For most of her career, she's worked in offices in major cities, including 12 years in New York. But now she's part of a program that pays remote workers thousands of dollars to base themselves in the northwest corner of Alabama.
It definitely was different, and a lot of people were like, what are you doing? You're moving to where? You know, and so having to explain to folks that, yeah, I'm moving to this area, but it's got so much value to it. They will give you up to $10,000 to relocate to the Shoals, which is a lot of money. But then when I looked online at the housing cost, it was so affordable that I could actually afford to purchase my first home. And that was just really exciting for me. And also, you don't just get a grant and that's it. Built into this, you are part of a community. The Shoals is just a really friendly, welcoming place.
Heather moved to Alabama before the coronavirus pandemic struck the US. But since then, she says there's been a big increase in interest from her friends and colleagues in working remotely and escaping the major cities.
I've been trying to coerce all of my colleagues, at least the ones I like, to relocate. But yeah, I definitely see an uptick. And when I talk to friends in New York, in San Francisco, they're for sure looking for other options. I had a few discussions with colleagues in San Francisco last week who were looking at housing outside of San Francisco for the first time. You know, up to this point, they were really happy living in the big city. They got what they needed from there. But with everything going on, it's just become really stressful. And so people are looking for different options, whether it's, you know, moving away, moving to smaller homes, buying RVs. You know, there's a huge uptick in RV sales right now. Like, yeah, people are looking for alternatives, and working remotely is the way that people are making that happen.
The Remote Shoals program that Heather signed up to is one of a handful of similar schemes set up in the last 2 years by small US cities and regions to attract remote workers. It's seen as a way to revitalize parts of the country that have seen talented workers drift away to the major coastal cities.
As someone who's lived on both coasts, I spent a large percentage of my time telling people that Tulsa was far cooler a city than they potentially expected.
Aaron Belsley is the executive director of Tulsa Remote, the program for the city of Tulsa in Oklahoma. Since it launched, it's had more than 20,000 applications from remote workers across the country. He says the boom in remote working in the pandemic is reinforcing an existing trend.
I think it's important to realize that individuals were looking to leave the major cities for a long time, even before COVID. The strain and stress of day-to-day life in a major city is real, and it continues to grow. Our goal was to identify those individuals who had already been thinking about moving away from major cities, show them that Tulsa was not only an option, but a really amazing place that they potentially have never considered, and help them get integrated into the community in hopes that over time, we can dramatically diversify the industry representation within our community, ensuring that this city is extremely resilient in the future.
So what kinds of workers are you looking to attract? What kinds of jobs are those people doing?
Well, what's really great about remote work is that every industry is taking advantage of it. Even before COVID, it was an aspect of our economy that was dramatically on the rise. We have artists and musicians and famous actresses and sports players and technologists and lawyers and doctors who have come through our program. The only real requirement is that the individuals who come through the program have the ability to work for a company based outside of Oklahoma and want to make a positive impact in the community in which they live.
Does that limit it in a way, though? Because the types of industries that are already employing remote work might be, you know, the tech companies in San Francisco spring to mind. You know, Twitter and Facebook have talked a lot about remote working. Does that mean that you end up attracting a lot of the young and trendy tech firms?
I would say that the young and trendy tech firms are definitely represented within our program. But to narrow the scope only to those individuals creates an ecosystem that I honestly didn't want to be a part of after a while. I lived in Silicon Valley for 10 years, and I honestly got exhausted by everybody working for a large tech company and everybody having the same kind of lifestyle. And I really yearned to have more diversity in that. And I think that's what we're creating here in Tulsa Remote.
Have you seen an uptick in interest in your program since the coronavirus pandemic started?
Absolutely. We've seen twice as many applications. So I absolutely believe that this is a tipping point. Historically, talent went where the jobs were, and now jobs go where the talent is. And in the past, we built our life around our job. And in the future, remote work allows us to build our jobs around our lives. And I think that companies that adopt remote work in a sustainable way now are going to have a competitive advantage in the future.
Aaron Belsley from Tulsa, Oklahoma, there, speaking to the BBC's Edwin Lane. So home working could help smooth out some of the inequalities between urban and rural areas in the US. But other kinds of inequalities may actually worsen. So says Nicholas Bloom. He's economics professor at Stanford University, where he studied the benefits and pitfalls of home working.
If you look at folks working in, you know, retail, gardeners, truck drivers, hardly any of them are working at home. They're either almost all working basically on business premises or they're actually not working.
So there's a real class divide there, isn't there?
Yes, it's a horrible issue that working from home in some senses is fantastic, that it's been one of our greatest weapons against COVID in the sense that we've been able to have a lockdown and, you know, the economy is staggered onwards. It's obviously not great, but it's a lot better than if we couldn't work from home. But as you say, it's been awful in terms of the class divide. So basically, those that, you know, previously already earning pretty well have been able to shift home relatively easily, and lower earning and typically less educated people have struggled to do that. And it's not just an issue, obviously, about being able to work now, but there's also longer run issues about health. So if you can work from home, it's much easier to self-isolate, and also experience. So even if the government, say, is giving you, cutting your stimulus check each month to replace what you would have earned, of course, once the pandemic ends, if you've been, you know, not working for 9 months, you've missed out on a lot of work experience, and it makes it harder to get a job when things recover.
You've spoken about this as generating a time bomb for inequality.
Yeah, I'm generally concerned about it. Inequality was already at astronomical levels, just horrible levels before the pandemic started. You know, to make it even worse, actually, the stock market's done quite well. So the wealthy, even their investments have actually not done too badly. And those that are earning less have struggled because they often can't work at home and their money's more tied up in, you know, they don't have much money. And, you know, to the extent it is, it hasn't done as well in physical assets like housing. It's not so obvious that's going to do as well. So, yeah, it's generated a real worry for me in terms of rising inequality, you know, both now, but also, you know, post-pandemic.
Is there anything that can be done to address that, though?
There is something you can do about it. It's not straightforward and it may not even be popular. I think it's one of the areas where, honestly, the government needs to step in through the tax system. I'm a big believer of free market economics, but there are certainly limits on what the free market can do. And in this case, I don't see any easy market-based solution. So my advice would be, of course, post-pandemic, we're going to have an enormous tsunami of debt. We already see it. Governments are borrowing huge amounts and that's going to need to be paid back. And I think it's only reasonable that higher earning people should pay the majority of the increase in taxes, because in large part, they're the ones that have actually probably suffered the least during the lockdown and post, because they can work from home.
I can't imagine that going down very well.
No, you know, it's worth pointing out a couple of things. One is we definitely wanted stimulus right now. Without stimulus, we risked being back in the 1929 to 33 situation of the Great Depression. So actually, policy's been very effective at preventing the economy completely collapsing. But that's required a lot of expenditure, which governments have borrowed.
What other impact should we watch for in this transition to more remote work so long as the pandemic lasts?
I think another huge phenomena is going to be pushback against cities, particularly the center of cities. So if you look at the history of really Europe and the US, and including actually, you know, the developing world, pretty much globally, cities have been beginning to boom from the 80s onwards. So, you know, to tell you a story from my childhood, I remember going to New York in the early 80s with my parents. It was the first time I ever traveled abroad. It was, you know, one of those, I grew up in Britain. It was a cheap, for us, you know, a cheap flight we managed to find. And I was shocked to find a McDonald's on Times Square. They had two security guards with guns. We realized in the early 80s that the center of places like Manhattan were poor, low rent, crime infested. Now in 2020 or 2019, it's completely reversed. So center of cities have boomed. The pandemic is just going to reverse a big chunk of that because A, we were working from home much more post-pandemic. So, of course, there'll be more time spent in the suburbs at home. And B, social distancing, I think, has obviously increased a lot now, but I think part of that is here to stay. And for example, I polled 2,500 Americans actually this week, and we find that the majority of them, so 75%, say they'd still feel nervous after a vaccine comes out, getting in a crowded elevator or subway.
That doesn't make any sense. Why would people be afraid if there's a vaccine? Surely a vaccine, you know, means immunity. Is it that they're worried about other pandemics? Is it just that the seed has been planted now in people's brain that pandemics are a real threat?
Yeah, I mean, there's two related things. One is you're much more conscious of infection. And then the second issue, as you point out, is a long run issue about could there be another pandemic? So just to be concrete, if you're a large US bank, say, you really probably don't want to put your entire firm at the top of a 50-story skyscraper in case one of these pandemics happens again.
Yeah, what you're painting there is a pretty bleak picture when it comes to future of work. I mean, it's a future where everyone's isolated in their own homes, tapping away at their computers in a very solitary way.
No, not at all. Okay. I totally disagree. So I don't think it's bleak at all, actually. I think it's very positive. So just to be clear, I'm not advocating for entirely working from home. I see us in future for the roughly 40 to 50% of us that can in the developed world work from home. And I know it's slightly lower shares, say, in, you know, Asia, Africa, South America, but there's still a large group of us that can work from home. We'll be doing that 2 to 3 days a week, and the other 2 to 3 days a week will be in the office. So post-COVID will be this kind of mix. And then secondly, I think we're going to be working much more in the suburbs, out of city centres, and it's going to actually rebalance a lot of our society. So there's been a huge issue in Europe and the US about the, you know, again, I go out a lot to Mumbai, I was in Tokyo recently, about the affordability crisis in the centre of big cities. And it's going to push back on it. It's going to make society more balanced. In many ways, it's going to reinvigorate rural communities that are actually in many parts of the world are really dying. So, no, I think it's one of the few good things to come out of COVID is that we're, you know, move people out of the center of cities and allow a more moderate balance between work and home.
Stanford University's Nicholas Bloom. But is the scenario he paints necessarily going to be replicated around the world? A question for Sarah Bana. She, together with researchers at MIT, wrote a recent report on how ready different countries are to adapt to mass remote working.
So we find very big variation between workers' conditions in terms of working from home, in terms of internet access and quality, demographic structure, so households that have children under 15. In a lot of countries, there are less than a quarter of the households that have children under 15. In some countries like Nigeria and Pakistan, more than 70% of households have children under 15. And so that just puts different amount of responsibility on parents who might be working from home. And then finally, previous experience with working from home. So there are some countries, for example, Sweden, almost 30% of people were working from home sometimes prior to the pandemic. And so that just implies differences in infrastructure and culture related to working from home that had already been established pre-COVID-19. Potentially, these workers have been provided a work laptop and also been taught how to tunnel in via remote desktop. I think that's something that a lot of companies taught their workers to do at the beginning of the pandemic, but still isn't necessarily extremely widespread.
Which countries are not well placed on this front?
So our bottom five countries are Nigeria, Pakistan, South Africa, Italy, and Brazil. The first two countries, Nigeria and Pakistan, like I said, there are a lot of households with children under the age of 15. And these countries also have much slower internet than a lot of other countries around the world. It's not just speed, but I also think it's access, and that relates to this rural-urban divide.
What are the economic consequences for those countries less able to work from home?
Yeah, so I think the ability to work from home makes it substantially easier to comply with social distancing measures while maintaining economic activity. And so if we think about regions where working from home is harder, those regions may be more susceptible to layoffs, depressed economic activity, and lower demand for products. If you don't get your hair cut, then that hairdresser has less money to spend on everything else. But working from home helps change that, right? Maybe not for the hairdresser, but if the radio program can still happen virtually, then you've allowed some workers to continue working. And that's valuable because those people's wages can continue to buy goods and services that support other people's jobs.
And that's why it's my economic duty to get lots of haircuts and manicures in my neighborhood while I still have a job that allows me to work from home. Digital economy researcher Sarah Bana there, ending this edition. From Edwin Lane and me, Manuela Saragosa, signing off from home.